So, good morning, everybody. So, today, our students of the MSc fourth year, fourth semester, they will be giving their final presentation on the basis of their term paper. So, welcome, students, and I would wish you all the best. And please try to give your presentation within 8 minutes and 2 minutes for discussion. Don't try to exceed the time. And it is really an honor that Dr. Suprabhat Mukherjee is the external evaluator for today's examination. The examination, the marks today will be evaluated on 25. So 25, within 20, the evaluation marks will be 25. So I would like to start the proceedings. And first person to present will be Abdul Jabbar Sheikh. Abdul, you can start presenting, please. Present your screen.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Good morning to my all respected teachers and my friends. Myself, Abdul Jabbar Sheikh, a student of MSc 4th semester Geology of BB College under Qazi Nazrul University. My term paper is about gold formation. Thank you for giving me such an opportunity to present my PPT in front of you. At first, introduction. Plants gall are familiar object of natural history. Galls are pathologically developed cells, tissue, and organs of the plants, which arise mostly by the hypertrophy and hyperplasy, usually under the influence of parasitic organism. Next slide about the term related to the gall. Gall, coming from the Latin word gala means okay, and cicidia from the Greek word kikidion means anything gushing out. Galls are a kind of swelling on the external tissue of the plants. The study of the plant gall known as cicidology and the gall maker known as cicidozoa include mites, beetles, psyllids, true bugs, wasps, and flies. After that, characteristics of gall. A gall is essentially a neoplastic growth characteristics by the cellular hypertrophy and hyperplasy. A gall arises as a result of the presence of the foreign body. A gall is the product of the natural interaction of the plant cells and the gall inducing agent. Next. Gall produced by wasps. Gall wasps are also known as gall flies, belong to the family Cynipidae and the order Hymenoptera, such as Andricus eris, responsible for the ram's horn gall on the oak. Next, gall produced by the psyllids. Psyllids are a family of the small plant feeding insects, belong to the order Hemiptera and family Psyllidae. Livia janchorum attacked the flowering spicule of the several kind of rush, causing the floral part become thick and leaf-like and from the tassel gall. After that, aphids as a gall inducing agent. Aphids are a small sap-sucking insect belong to the family Apidae and order Hymenoptera, commonly known as green fly or black fly. The Apidae Aedilgus coli are usually longer and often strongly carved from the gall on the Sitka spruce. The present slide is about the gall induced by the midge. Midges are very fragile and small insect belonging to the family Cicidomyidae and order Diptera. The gall midge, genitalia fancrumi, produced gall on the stem of the barren rose. Next, beetle as a gall-inducing agent. Beetle are a group of the insect belonging to the order Coleoptera. Saparta populni is a beetle whose larvae live in the twigs of the poplar and from a spherical or egg-shaped gall. After that, gall induced by the mites. Mites are microscopic plant parasite of the class Arachnida and the family Areophidae. The gall mites, Hartiola annulipes, is responsible for the cylindrical growth on the beech leaves. After that, bacterial gall. Agarobacterium tumefaciens is an example of the bacteria which is responsible for gall production, known as crown gall. After that, fungal gall. Ascomycetes fungus, Taphina alni, infect the scale of the female alder catkins, causing them to develop into remarkable tongue-like gall. Present host plant of the gall. Oak belong to the family Fagaceae, where ram horn gall is produced by the Andricus eris. Barrent rose belong to the family Rosaceae, here the gall produced by the Diplolepis. After that, types of the galls. According to the complexity, galls are two types, indeterminate and determinants. And according to the opening, it is also two types, that is the dehiscent and indehiscent. According to the shape, gall classified into erineal gall, pouch gall, rosette gall, and erineated gall. After that, the modern hypothesis of the gall formation. Bone tissue become active first, then the surrounding cell together translocate the active metabolites at the site of the wound. These active metabolites help to produce indole acetic acid precursors, which ultimately produce auxin. That is the main chemical responsible for the gall production. After that, the comparison between plant gall and the tumor. Gall is induced by insect and mites, whereas tumor induced by the nematode virus and fungi and bacteria. Galls are radial or bilateral symmetry, whereas tumor is amorphous or asymmetrical growth. Generally, gall occur upper part of the tree, where tumor also occur in the root portion. Indole acetic acid play an important role for the plant gall formation, whereas cytokine and auxin play an important role in formation tumor. After that, harmful effect of gall on the host plant. The vascular system of the plant may be damaged, infested leaves which can be twisted and curled. Over time, weakened portion of the tree generally decline the plant vigor. Next, protection of the host plant. Gall producer are easily kept control the natural enemies, use of cultural control by racking and destroying the fallen leaves by pruning off and the destroying gall infested trees and the branches. Spray must be used as a preventive before the gall formation, as qualified arborist will be needed for spray on the tree. After this use of the gall, gall are rich in resin and tannic acid and have been used in the manufacture of the permanent ink and dyes and the tannin. The primary use of the gall was modern for the black dyes, used in medicine and as an antiquity and therapeutic also. After that conclusion, at last it can be said that gall are abnormal plant growth due to the attack of the insect, and gall may develop all trees. Gall are not so harmful to plant and have an excellent importance in human welfare. Acknowledgement. Firstly, I would acknowledge Dr. Arnav Ganguly, Sir, HOD of our department, for giving me such an opportunity to take this topic as a term paper. And I am also deeply grateful, Sri Raja Mukherjee, Sir, and Dr. Sangeeta Lahiri, Ma'am, who has endowed me valuable suggestion, guidance, and active support at every step of for concluding the term paper. References, take my references from MS Mani, Plant Gall in India, and Mitchell's Chenery, Britain's Plant Gall, and the website like Wikipedia. Thank you to all.
Thank you, Abdul. And, it was very nicely presented. Now, this is open for discussion for 2 minutes. Suprabhat, do you
have... Okay. Abdul, nice yes, presentation. I just have only one question. As you have said that gall is induced by the insects and some microbes. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So, what kind of intervention strategy you will propose?
দিক থেকে অনেকটা ক্ষতি করে এবং এদের আমরা দেখছিলাম যে ভাস্কুলার সিস্টেমকে অ্যাটাক করছে, তো গল
ঠিক আছে, বলো কোন ধরনের প্ল্যান্টে গল বেশি হয়, যেগুলো যে উন্ডেড প্ল্যান্ট না যেগুলো নর্মাল হেলদি প্ল্যান্ট, কোন প্ল্যান্টে বেশি গল হয়?
উন্ডেড প্ল্যান্ট।
হরাইজন্টাল ম্যানার খালি
ওকে স্যার।
হ্যাঁ কোনটাকে? হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ পারফেক্ট, এভরিথিং ইজ পারফেক্ট, পারফেক্ট। ওকে স্টার্ট।
Good morning, respected teachers and my friends. I am Bipasha Modok, going to present a presentation of my term paper based on the topic Forensic Entomology, where insects speak the truth. Science is used to solve crimes. In fact, it is instrumental in resolving cases involving both civil and criminal issues. The term forensic is defined as pertaining to or connected with the law, while science is the study of the physical and natural world. But what is the role of insect in solving such criminal cases? As we all know, insects are most successful creatures on earth, and the other one is human. And human use insects for solving crimes for their unique ability from a very early ages. And the branch in which human takes the help of insects is termed as forensic entomology. So the forensic entomology is the application of the study of insects and other arthropods to legal issues. The field of forensic entomology has a much history than we might suspect, dating all the way back to the 13th century. The earliest known case of a crime being solved using insect evidence comes from China. In 1247, the Chinese lawyer Sang Tzu's wrote a textbook on criminal investigations called The Washing Away of Wrongs. From this book, we know that the local investigator of China solved the murder case by seeing the attraction of flies to one of the sickles of villagers and concluded that the flies were attracted to the sickle because of invisible remnants of blood and the murderer confessed to the crime. Before 1829, it was believed that flies are attracted by corpses at a very early stage of decomposition. The most important year in forensic entomology is 1855, when Dr. Barger first introduced PMI in the field of forensic entomology. By the beginning of 21st century, forensic entomology came to the accept as an important forensic tool in many countries. When a person dies, a body immediately becomes a potential resource for insect colonization. According to Smith, four categories of insects can be found on a decomposing carrion. Among of them, order Diptera and Coleoptera are most important. Some species of from this group, two groups are shown here. Though insects are very advanced in solving crimes, but not much is known about what attracts insects to a decomposing body. Researchers suspect that the odors released by the microbes as they break down the body are a major factor. Some sulfur and ammonium based compound present on the carrion is also responsible for attraction. When a dead body goes through the decomposition process, insects attract to the carrion. It is the state of rotting or decaying. Five stages of decomposition are mainly described. These are phase stage, which is the period between the moment of death and when the first sign of blot are apparent. The first insects to arise at site, usually Calliphoridae. The first visible sign of blot stage is a slight inflation of the abdomen, color changes and odor is noticeable. As shown in the picture, the active decay stage is characterized by wet appearance and strong odor of putrefaction. In advanced decay stage, most of the flesh is removed from the carcass and very little remains of the carcass found in the dry decay stage. Decomposition of dead body is controlled by some factors. Low temperature generally slows down the activity of flies, whereas garments like tight-fitting traps can advance the stages of decay during warm weather. Presence of pesticides and drugs sometimes slow down the rate of flies colonization, where most or more fat on the body allows faster decomposition. In forensic entomology, insects are mainly used to know the time of death. PMI or postmortem interval is the time between death and examination of body. The forensic pathological methods of PMI determination are viable only in the early postmortem period. But when the human remains are found beyond 48 to 72 hours, weeks, or even longer after death, such methods to a degree become unreliable and inaccurate. The rate of succession of defined insects are shown in the graphical presentation. As I have already shown that the rate of insects colonization on a cadaver is related to temperature, this model relates thermal energy directly to time, specifically examining the relation between growth and the temperature. When a body is decaying, some important changes are visible. Cooling of the body occurs after death, since all metabolism comes to a stop. known as algor mortis, and a purplish blue discoloration occurs in livor mortis after 30 minutes of death. After death, muscles can be moved easily. Joints are frozen. This stage is known as rigor mortis. The primary purpose of forensic entomology is to determine elapsed time since death, but it is also used to determining the mode of death as well as the place of death. Here, I mentioned six most important cause of death, which is characterized by presence of insects of different life stages. Some insects will colonize wounds on unclean areas on a living person, known as miasis. It is a very common in case of child or senior abuse or neglect. As shown in the picture, miasis like cutaneous, nasopharyngeal, auricular, intestinal, or urogenital miasis occurs due to the infestation of the skin by developing larvae of a variety of fly species. To determine the cause of death, it is very important to do the molecular analysis of insects. A study by Zehna 2004 demonstrated that when maggots ingest the human tissue, the tissue can be extracted from the crop, undergo STR analysis, and generate a profile that can be compared against a corpse from which the maggots were feeding. To identify the dead body through the DNA, DNA typing method is applicable. It is 99.685% reliable, and this DNA typing method is first used to solve a badly burned body discovered with its face and neck colonized by fly larvae. But sometimes transfer of a cadaver to a new colony or location can alter microenvironmental conditions, such as climate, indoor-outdoor condition, etc. It is essential for forensic entomologists to follow some rules of insect collection from cadavers. Here I have mentioned 10 basic rules a forensic entomologist must have knowledge about photography as well as chemicals like ethanols to store the insect or maggots. Nowadays, forensic entomology is very famous, and many scientists all over the world are working for the advancement of this field. Now I am going to present some recent research on this field. A new study published in the Journal of Medical Entomology shows that the other insect ones that are not normally associated with the human corpses also interact with dead bodies. In the given picture, a caterpillar found ingesting dried skin near the toenail of cadaver. Also, a scorpion fly is present. This provides more clue for forensic entomologists for future. Researchers at Cranfield University are using blowflies and other insects to develop a database by using cuticular hydrocarbons. This is a new insect database provide a library for forensic entomologists to refer to when investigating cases. A technique called direct analysis in real time or dark mass spectrometry gives forensic entomologists a faster fly IDs. Scientists at the University at Albany combined a quick mass spectrometry method with an innovative statistical model. It analyzes a sample instantly, making traditional time-consuming mass spectrometry look cloudy. Now I am going to present a very hot topic, which is solved by forensic entomology. That is, the researchers of Mardoch University have made a promising discovery which could aid investigation into sexually motivated homicide. In case of sexual assault followed by homicide, investigation can be extremely challenging due to the fast degradation of the semen. But researchers found that the human DNA from the semen successfully even after 12 days of homicide. These all researches and findings introduced us to a new era of forensic entomology. Here, I am presenting some articles and newspaper reports regarding forensic entomology. Some of them are very famous newspaper of that time. Forensic entomology can assist the pathologist in necrotic or drug intoxication of the cadaver. Entomotoxicology is a very important branch of forensic entomology which analyzes the carrion feeding insect to detect toxic substances. If a person dies by such toxins like barbiturate, cocaine, or even poison, insect can reveal it, and by analyzing their body content, scientists can prove the cause of death. To investigate such cases, some modern investigation methodologies are needed. Here I am presenting such methodologies. Among of them, mitochondrial DNA and scanning electron microscope are famous. Though the foreign country advanced in this, but nowadays India is also very. Dr. Pankaj Kulshrestha of Medical Legal Institute and other scientists like.
Bipasha, I think you should conclude it. You have exceeded your time.
Yes, sir. Very, very nice.
Please conclude it very fast, and yes, so we could open it for discussion.
Sir, our conclusion is actually chole eschi.
Okay, fine, fine. Go ahead.
Though forensic entomology has various advantages, but there are some limitations also. I have mentioned these limitations in my presentation. Forensic entomology may not be the last word in all death investigations, but the evidence from insects, if investigated by right person and with right techniques, can certainly complement and supplement other conventional procedures in forensic entomology. This is all about my presentation. At last, I would like to thank Dr. Amitabh Basu, principal of BB College, and our HOD sir, Dr. Arnav Ganguly, for giving me the opportunity to take this topic as my term paper. And I would like to acknowledge specially our mentors, Dr. Shongita Lahiri ma'am and Sri Raja Mukherjee sir, for their constant help. Thank you all.
Thank you very much. Is there any questions?
Diva sir, it's a very good presentation. It's a pleasure to see that a student from MSc is studying the research papers. It's really a pleasure. I just have only one question. Can you cite any recent case study where that forensic entomology was used to investigate any kind of crime station?
Yes, sir. Recent study, bolte je amra sobai jani je Sushant Sing er je case ta hoyeche. ড্রাগসের বা যেটা হয়েছে ওইখানেও সুশান্ত সিং এর যখন ডেড বডিটা পাওয়া গেছিল ওর উপর কিছু ব্লো ফ্লাইস পাওয়া গেছিল যেগুলো ক্যালিফোর্নিয়ান ফ্যামিলির অন্তর্গত তো এটা নিয়ে এখন ফরেনসিক এন্টোমোলজিস্ট তো মানে ওই
একটা কোশ্চেন আছে ছোট কোশ্চেন সেটা হলো হোয়াট কাইন্ড অফ মলিকুলার বায়োলজিক্যাল টেকনিক উইল ইউ ইউজ টু স্টাডি দা ফিঙ্গারপ্রিন্ট অফ আ সাসপেক্ট
মলিকুলার ফরেন্সিক এন্টোমোলজিস্ট এন্টোমোলজির মধ্যে মলিকুলার বায়োলজিকে অ্যাটাচ করা হয়েছে আমরা যা ওই ডার্ক মেথড এবং যে এসটিএম মেথড আছে সেই মেথডের সাথে প্রথমে
এন্টোমোলজিস্ট এটা কমনলি ইউজড টেকনিকের নাম বলো
হ্যাঁ স্যার
সবথেকে কমনলি ইউজড একটা টেকনিকের নাম বলো
সবথেকে কমনলি ইউজড টেকনিকের নাম হচ্ছে স্যার এসটিআর ওই তো সবার আগে ছিল এখন তার সাথে ডার্ট
কম্বাইন করা হচ্ছে কমন ইউজ টেকনিক হচ্ছে আরএফএলপি ওকে রেস্ট্রিকশন ফ্র্যাগমেন্ট দেন ফলো আপ ওকে স্যার ওকে মোস্ট কমন টেকনিক ওকে থ্যাংক ইউ ফর ইওর ভেরি গুড প্রেজেন্টেশন
থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার
থ্যাংক ইউ বিপাশা সো এন্ড নাও আই উড রিকোয়েস্ট দেবাঞ্জলি টু গিভ হার প্রেজেন্টেশন দেবাঞ্জলি সরকার
সে শোনা যাচ্ছে
হ্যাঁ ইউ আর অডিবল
সে শুরু করবো স্যার
হ্যাঁ শুরু করো একদম শুরু করো
ওকে স্যার গুড মর্নিং স্যার মাইকেল দেবাঞ্জলি
এ স্টুডেন্ট অফ পিজি ডিপার্টমেন্ট জুলজি বিবি কলেজ I am thankful to the Kazi Nazrul University for introducing this dissertation as a compulsory in the postgraduate syllabus of zoology. Today, I will present on bioluminescence in insects. The silent sparks of fireflies on a summer night seem so magical. It always attracts me since childhood. So when a living organism produces and emits light as a result of a chemical reaction, the process is known as bioluminescence. Bioluminescence is a product of a chemical reaction in an organism, so it is also called chemiluminescence. Bioluminescence involves a class of chemicals called luciferin and luciferase. Here, less than 20% of light is thermal radiation, so it is also called cold light emission. What is difference between the bioluminescence and the fluorescence? The fluorescence involves the excitation and emission of light, but in bioluminescence, the chemical energy is transformed into light.
A great diversity of the insects has been found to possess the ability to emit light. Bioluminescence is known to occur in various Coleoptera as well as in few Colymbola, such as Onycurus armatus, in the Hemiptera, such as Phalgora lanterneria, and in some larval Diptera of the families Platyuridae and Bolitophyllidae. The light-producing organs occur in various parts of the body. Onycurus species emits glow from the whole body. In Photiurus species, there is an pair of light organ in the ventral region of each of the 6th and 7th abdominal segments. But in female, the light organs are smaller and only occur in one segment. In Phalgora, the light organ is in the head. Each light organ of an adult firefly consists of a number of large cells called photocytes, which lie just beneath the epidermis and are backed by several layers of cells called dorsal layer cells. The cuticle overlying the light organ is transparent, and the photocyte form a series of cylinder with trachea and the nerves running through the core of each cylinder. After entering in the photocyte, the trachea gives up tracheoles. The origin of the tracheoles enclosed within tracheal end cell and the trachealar cell. The photocytes are packed with photocyte granules. Light is produced in the peroxisomes. The luciferin oxidizes in the presence of a catalytic enzyme luciferase to create light and an ineffective compound oxyluciferin. It is a two-stage reaction: adenylation of the luciferin and the oxygenation of the luciferyl adenylate. The light produced by the bioluminescence organs is yellow green in color, extending 520 to 650 nanometer in Photinus and the Lampyris. In case of railroad worm, where the light organs on the thorax and abdomen produce green to orange light, and that on the head produces red light. Various modes of light emissions giving the different glow pattern: the continuous glow, that is produced without interruption, and the intermittent glow lasts only for few seconds. The pulsation glow, light is emitted in pulses ranging 6 to 13 pulses per minute. And the flash of glow consists of a burst of light which remains only for a short duration with greater intensity. How this light production is controlled? In adult photiurids, the light production appears to be regulated by availability of oxygen. As the neurons from the doom cells terminate on the tracheal end cells, the neural activity causes a change in the cells and facilitating the flow of oxygen to the photocytes. Oxygen arriving at mitochondria is used by the peroxisome oxidases to form hydrogen peroxide. This triggers the flash. Inosynthase is located near the synaptic terminals within the firefly lantern. As the release of ENO that diffuses into the periphery of adjacent photocytes, this inhibits the mitochondrial respiration and permits oxygen to diffuse into the photocytes. The bioluminescence is used by living things to defend against predators as defensive adaptation, and the second one to hunt prey as offensive adaptation. They perform mimicry, finding mates, and to execute other vital activities. The phenomenon of bioluminescence is utilized as a valuable scientific tool in many biological experiments. So bioluminescence provides a new dimension to space research, medical research, pest management, fluorescent marker gene, street lights into the tree lights. But the light pollution, exposed to pesticides, destruction of their habitats, leads them disappearing from their long established habitats. So biologists are rushing to understand what is happening to the fireflies so we can save them before their lives fade permanently. I would like to express my special thanks of gratitude to Professor Dr. Essel ma'am and Professor RM sir for their guidance. I would also like to extend my gratitude to HOD sir, Professor Dr. AG sir, PD sir, and my friends for helping me out. I took reference from the book Chapman, Tenvare, and mentioned journals. So this is my presentation. Thank you, sir, my friends present here. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Devanjali. Now it's open for discussion. Shuprabhat.
Devanjali, nice presentation.
Thank you, sir.
And your voice is extremely good. Good voice is a very plus point in any kind of scientific presentation. So I want to just I want to know that what is the correlation between the study that you have done in your dissertation with your entomology special paper?
Sir,
Akbar,
bolun. কাজে লাগছে, মেডিকেল রিসার্চে হচ্ছে, তারপর পেস্ট ম্যানেজমেন্ট এর হেল্প রয়েছে।
কনক্লুশনে কনক্লুশনে একটা কথা বলি, সেটা হচ্ছে লাইট পলিউশন। ক্যান ইউ জাস্ট ইলাবোরেট হোয়াট ইজ লাইট, হোয়াট ডু ইউ মিন বাই লাইট পলিউশন?
লাইট পলিউশন মানে হচ্ছে এখন যে পলিউশন গ্লোবাল ওয়ার্মিং হচ্ছে, তাতে এই রাতের যেরকম যে ডেন্সিটিটা থাকছে, মানে অন্ধকারে যে কালো হাওয়াটা, সেটা অতটা থাকছে না। আর ওদের মেইনলি এই ডার্ক নাইটে বেশি দরকার রয়েছে সার্ভাইভের জন্য, অতটা ডার্ক হয় না এখন আগের মতো।
এক্স্যাক্টলি, তার মানে কি হচ্ছে যে ইনসেক্ট গুলো, ইনসেক্টের পপুলেশন কমে যাচ্ছে, যেহেতু লাইট পলিউশন বাড়ছে মানে ডার্কনেস কমছে, আর্টিফিশিয়াল লাইটের ইউজ বেশি হচ্ছে, মানে ইনসেক্ট পপুলেশন আস্তে আস্তে নষ্ট হয়ে যাচ্ছে, তাই তো?
হ্যাঁ
হ্যাঁ, কি রেমেডি দেয়া যাবে এটাতে? তাহলে এই যে ইকোলজিক্যাল ইমব্যালেন্স হচ্ছে, এটাকে কিভাবে কি রেমেডি দিবি বায়োলুমিনেসেন্স এর পারসপেক্টিভ থেকে?
আমাদের এই স্রাব ল্যান্ড গুলোকে বাঁচাতে হবে আগে, যাতে ওদের আমরা তাদের ফুড আর শেল্টার থেকে মেন প্রোভাইড করতে পারি। ওটা ধ্বংস করে দিলে ওরা বাঁচতে পারবে না।
ওকে ওকে, থ্যাংক ইউ, থ্যাংক ইউ,
থ্যাংক ইউ ভেরি মাচ, অ্যান্ড দেবাঞ্জলি থ্যাংক ইউ, অ্যান্ড দ্য নেক্সট স্পিকার ইজ মানিকুল ইসলাম শেখ। মানিকুল আছো?
ইয়েস স্যার, আমি স্ক্রিন শেয়ার করছি। দেখা যাচ্ছে স্যার?
হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ, দেখা যাচ্ছে, শোনাও যাচ্ছে। গো হেড, স্টার্ট।
ওকে স্যার। গুড মর্নিং মাই রেসপেক্টেড টিচার্স অ্যান্ড অল মাই ফ্রেন্ডস, মাইসেলফ মানিকুল ইসলাম শেখ, ফোর্থ সেমিস্টার এমএসসি ইন জুলজি আন্ডার দ্য কাজী নজরুল ইউনিভার্সিটি। টুডে আই এম গোয়িং টু প্রেজেন্ট মাই পিপিটি অন মালবেরি সেরিকালচার, অ্যান্ড থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার ফর গিভিং মি দিস অপরচুনিটি। ইন্ট্রোডাকশন। দ্য ওয়ার্ড সেরিকালচার কামস ফ্রম দ্য গ্রিক ওয়ার্ড সেরিকস, সেরি মিন সিল্ক and cos means culture. The rearing of the silkworm for the production of the silk is called as sericulture. Silk is obtained from some insects, which are the silk moth Bombyx mori, feeds on the mulberry plant, and hence the silk is known as the mulberry silk, and commercially silk obtained from other insects known as the non-mulberry silk. Next is about history of sericulture. Historical evidences shows that silkworm first discovered in China, but later it spread to other parts of the world. Next, in this slide, I have inserted a table that shows four different types of silk, and their host plants and the silkworms and the distribution in India, etc. Next, silkworm, mulberry silkworm. The mulberry silkworm is the Bombyx mori under the order Lepidoptera and family Bombycidae. And silk is produced by this silkworm is called the mulberry silk. It feeds on the leaves of the mulberry plants. Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, West Bengal, Jammu, Kashmir, which together accounts for 92% of country's total raw mulberry silk. Next, life cycle of Bombyx mori. Bombyx mori, being a holometabolous insect, undergoes complete metamorphosis with four stages in their life cycle: egg, larva, pupa, and adult. Adult moth. The adult Bombyx mori do not take any food and incapable to fly. Their lifespan is only 3 to 6 days. The body consists of three parts: head, thorax, and abdomen. Head is small and bears mouth, antenna, and two compound eyes are present. Thorax has three segments: prothorax, mesothorax, and metathorax. Each thoracic segment bears a pair of five jointed legs. abdomen. Male has 8 abdominal segments with a pair of hooks that are actually help in copulation. Eggs. After mating of 12 to 24 hours, the pair get separated and female starts laying eggs. Mostly female lay about 150 to 300 eggs. There are two types of eggs are found, diapause eggs and non-diapause eggs. Diapause eggs hatch out within 11 to 14 days and non-diapause takes about 9 to 12 days. Larva. The larva of Bombyx mori is commonly called the silkworm. During growth, the larva molts 4 times. It is 3 mm long and black in color. It takes about 21 to 25 days for hatching. Pupa. Once the cocoon formation is over, the larva molts inside and transforms into the pupa, and this process is called pupation. The pupal stage continues about 10 to 12 days. In this slide, the whole process of sericulture actually divides into 3 main steps: cultivation of mulberry plants, rearing of cocoon, reeling of cocoon. Next, mori culture. The cultivation of the mulberry plants is called the mori culture. Favorable soil for mulberry growth are sandy loam and clay loam. The soil pH under water retaining capacity of field, quality of mulberry variety, temperature, etc. actually influence on leaf yield. Planting process. Plantation can be done by two ways: peat system and in row system. The peat system, in peat system, there are 3 inch into 3 inch spacing are used, and for row system there are 2 inch into 2 inch spacings are used. Next, rearing of cocoons. Selection of silkworm race. Multi-volatile races should be selected for having the capability to complete 5 to 6 life cycle per year. But in India, bi and univoltine mulberry are also selected. Silkworm seed production. Hybrids of multi-volatile and bi-volatile reared commonly commercially for its superior quality and huge quantity of the eggs. Grainage. These are the places where seeds are protected at large scales. Healthy, disease-free cocoons or pure races are selected and preserved at 23 to 25 degrees centigrade in wooden trays. And after emergence, it transfers into the plastic trays allowed to copulate with the males. And within 12 hours, the female lay about 400 to 600 eggs. Reeling of cocoons, harvesting. It is removing and selection operation of cocoons from mountains and sell them to market or to transport to the reeling industry. Reeling, removal of the silk thread. About 58% of the silk in each cocoon is reeable, and in this steps, cocoon drying, cocoon boiling and brushing methods are also used. This picture actually showing the whole processes that are involved in silk production. Next, silk. Silk is a proteinaceous secretion from the silk gland of mature silkworm larva. It has two main components. One is the fibroin and another is the sericin. Silk gland. Bilaterally symmetrical paired structure, and the anterior part of the paired ducts unite into apex and it opens into the spinnerets. It has 3 layers and 3 regions also: posterior regions, medial regions and anterior regions. Posterior regions are highly folded and secretes fibroin, and middle region W-shaped that secretes sericin. Economic importance of mulberry sericulture. The mulberry silkworm moth is very useful and valuable insects. It produces 2 important products like silk and guard. Silk is used in preparation of silk cloth, and on the basis of that silk, industry is established, and guard also used in surgical and fishing purposes. Sericulture has some other importance like high employee potential, low gestation and high returns, weekend friendly occupation, etc. Disease of mulberry sericulture. Some major diseases are related with mulberry sericulture like pebrine. Protozoan disease produces pepper-like spots on body. Fletchery, bacterium disease that body become black-green. Muscardine, it is a fungal disease. And Glazeri. Borrelina virus causes swelling of segments and skin rupture. Some enemies are of mulberry sericultures are eugenfly. In India, eugenfly is the major enemies of mulberry sericulture. Young maggots bore into the body of silkworms and live and eat fat body for about a week and causing a death. And some other enemies are like beetles, ants, etc. Spherical, in India, some research centers are present like Central Research and Training Institute, Karnataka, West Bengal and Bangalore, and the Central Silk Board established in the year 1958. The activities of the board is research and technology development, seed maintenance and development of sericulture and silk industry. In conclusion, I'd like to say that sericulture is one of the most important agro-based industry, includes various activities like cultivation of the mulberry plant and reeling of the cocoons and rearing of the cocoons, and this mammoth task create a huge platform of vacancy for job seekers. I would like to extend my gratitude to many people who helped me during this term paper. And firstly, I would like to thank Dr. Anum Ganguly sir, our HOD, to give me this opportunity to take this topic as term paper. And I also like to thank Dr. Sangeeta Lahiri ma'am and Mr. Raja Mukherjee sir for their constant support and valuable knowledge which provide during this time. I am very helped by these books that are elementary and applied zoology, a textbook, applied entomology, modern entomology, and www.slideshare.com. Thank you for your kind attention, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Manipul. It was really very nice overview of sericulture. Now your topic is open for discussion.
Thank you, sir.
Manipul, thanks yes, once again for your beautiful presentation. So I just want to know that you said that fibrin is one of the major protein in silk fiber. So what kind of protein structure you will find in fibrin?
What kind of protein structure? Beta plated.
That means it's a what kind of structure? Primary, secondary, tertiary, or quaternary?
It is tertiary, sir.
No.
You were saying something. It's beta pleated sheets, right?
Beta pleated sheets, sir. Actually, secondary.
Yes.
Secondary
structure. Alpha sheets and beta sheets are the secondary structures.
Yes, sir.
Okay, Manipul. And the silk fiber. What are the environmental factor that actually decides the quality of the silk fiber?
Silk fiber, actually, sir, silk fiber er quality depend kore bibhinno jinish er upor jemon jekhane chash hobe tar jomir matir quality er upor tar pore tar temperature tar environment tar pH ei somosto kichu nirbhor korbe sir ekta silk fiber koto ta unnati hobe ar ki ei sob kichur upori
no nutrition the plant, the quality of the plant, jarbo grow korbe the mulberry plant the nutritional status. Right? Okay.
Yes,
okay.
Thank you, Monikul. It was wonderful. And now I would like to invite Priya Mukherjee to
thank you, sir.
Welcome, Monikul. Priya, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Okay, Priya, go ahead.
Okay, sir. So should I start?
Yes, please do. Please start.
Hello, sir.
Present your screen and start.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for being here today. I am Priya Mukherjee, student of BB College Postgraduate Department. Today, I will talk to you about edible insects have future prospect for food and feed security. The world population is growing at a much faster speed than the food supplied. This increase leads to scarcity in resources like land. Hello, sir.
Yeah, go ahead. You're audible. Go ahead.
Okay, sorry. Okay, sir. Thank you.
It's going fine.
Okay, sir. This increase leads to scarcity resources like land and water, make a form more difficult to end with the question, how exactly we will feed 9 billion of people? More importantly, how can we grow with nutritious and sustainable food? Insects are among the most abundant and nutritious animal on the planet. Grown at a large scale, insects like grasshopper, crickets, mealworms, even cockroaches might be the entities to feed 9 billion of people. The practice of consuming insects is known as entomophagy. Insects offer some protein for the future. When that is sustainable, nutritious, and tastes delicious. Insects are sustainable because they are so efficient, and they are efficient because they can be farming. This means they don't undertake the complex and energy-intensive physiological processes the other insects, other animals like cows and humans. In order to regulate their body temperature, this allows to convert whatever we eat onto mass on their body much more efficiently. Now, what is feed efficiency? It is the ratio that how much food an animal need to consume in order to put on 1 pound of weight. Cows are among the most inefficient protein, requiring 25 pounds of feed to produce 1 pound of beef. Crickets, on the other hand, require 2 pounds of feed to produce 1 pound of cricket protein powder. Cows also require 2,000 gallons of water to produce 1 pound of beef. Cricket, they require only 1 gallon. Crickets and insects also have remarkable sources of nutrition. Crickets have more protein than beef jerky, chicken, salmon, and eggs. They have more iron than spinach and more calcium than milk. Another fact that supports eating insects is that they require very little in terms of physical space. You can't stock cows on top of each other, but you can grow insects in closed spaces. Right now, 30% of the world land is divided to raising animals for meat. So growing insects in a closed spaces can leave a pressure on land resources. Insects are also reported to emit fewer greenhouse gases than cattle and require significantly less land and water for rearing. Crickets require a fraction of land, water, and food and produce less greenhouse gases and ammonia. In addition to the environmental and nutritional benefits of feeding insects to human or livestock, there are also economic benefits. Insect farming can provide a stable income for farmers. Thus, insect harvesting in developing or underdeveloped countries provide a great opportunity for new businessmen and women sailors, which lead to women empowerment. There are many major groups of edible insects, such as the mopane caterpillar are the large edible caterpillars. They can be eaten by as dry, as crunchy as potato chips. Another type of edible insects are the larvae of palm weevil. Weevil larvae can be eaten fried, boiled, and also even raw. Termites and stink bugs are also a kind of edible insects. Now, the edible grasshopper, Ruspolia deferens. The deep-fried grasshopper is tasty and crunchy. They are protein-rich, so it provides common food sources in many parts of Africa. There are some different important products which we can get from insects, such as bees products, including honey, propolis, beeswax, and other products such as carmine and larb. Carmine is a red dye used for food and cosmetics. And there are many silkworm products, which are also available in the market. Larp is a sugary secretion derived from the insects, an important food source for birds. Honey is a gift from bees, which is a very nutritious food rich in energy and vitamins. These are various bees products which we use in regular diseases. Having all these benefits of consuming insects, but there are some risk of zoonotic infection. A zoonosis is an infection or infestation shared in nature by humans and wild or domestic animal. So maybe I managed to convince you that insects are sustainable, and yes, they are nutritious. Mealworms have a sort of nutty, crunchy consistency that reminds me of eating this. It has also been seen that some ants are sweeter than honey and more tart than lemons. These are all about my presentation. I would like to express my gratitude toward all teachers present here and Ma'am Dr. Shongita Lahiri and Sir Sri Raja Mukherjee, who were the mentors of my term paper work, and our beloved HOD Sir Dr. Arnab Ganguly and Sir Professor Pankaj Datta, who provide me this opportunity. Thank you, our external Sir, for coming here. Thanks to my friends and other teachers. Thank you. And one thing I must say, around the world, 2 billion of people consume insects as a part of their traditional diets, precisely because they offer delicious tastes of flavor. So insects are food. That is, entomophagy is the future. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Priya. Thank you very much. That's a nice presentation. Despite your problems which you're facing in your home, I wish a speedy recovery and everything sorts out fine in your play, in your home. And I would like to open this for discussion.
Thank you. Thank you, Priya, for your presentation. Really, it was a really nice presentation. So I have two questions. First one is that, what kind of sugars are present in honey that makes the honey sweeter?
Sir, hexose sugars are present, especially, sir, I think fructose.
Okay, yes, it is fructose. And second question is that you said that good fats are present in the insect. So, what are good fats?
Sorry, sir, repeat again.
You said that good fats are present in insect based food. Okay, so what are good fats?
Sir, growth facts, actually insects are protein rich, nutritious rich. So if we can consume insects as for our food, then we can also get many proteins, many nutrients and vitamins. As I have also mentioned that honey is a rich, vitamin rich, mineral rich component. So if we consume honey as our regularly based routine, then...
Priya, the question is, what are good fats? Fats. What do you mean by good fat?
Fat,
yeah.
Oh, sorry, sir. Actually, okay, sir. Sir, fat. I think amar kotha jana nei, but sir, amar mone hoy saturated fatty acids to thakte pare. Amar sir jana.
Saturated or unsaturated? Saturated fats or unsaturated fats?
Both. I am a bit confused. Fatty hote pare.
What are bad fats?
আচ্ছা, স্যাচুরেটেড ফ্যাটি অ্যাসিড ভালো না আনস্যাচুরেটেড ভালো শরীরের জন্য? এই যে আমরা তেল খাই, কি লেগে থাকে? পুফা এনরিচড। পুফা মানে কি?
স্যার, আমরা পলি আনস্যাচুরেটেড ফ্যাটি অ্যাসিড।
তো
হোয়াট আর দ্যাট? They are good fats.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm saturated better. Sir, ek to confusion ho gayi.
Mustard oil. Because of our double bond, they are bent. And so they don't form interlinking like your ghee or coconut oil or palm olive oil. All these things, they form saturations. They are not good for health. They accumulate in your arteries.
Yes.
Okay, sir.
Yes.
Okay.
So
আমরা খাই কমনলি খাই ইনজেক্টর নাম্বার
আমরা খাই স্যার মানে আমরা
হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ which
insects sir amra actually sir amra to insect product to khai je rokom honey khai ar echharao mane insects khai
direct insects
khai sir amar to edible insects e bolte gele coleopter er moddhe cricket eguloi mane jana ache ar cockroach khai
amra khai
are tumi cockroach khai thailand e khaye alu bhajar jaygay cockroach bhaja
thailand e ha চিংড়ি খাস না? চিংড়ি
আর্থ্রোপোডা? ও হ্যাঁ স্যার,
ক্রাস্টেশিয়ান। ওটা ক্রাস্টেশিয়ান, এক্স্যাক্টলি ইনসেক্ট নয়, বাট ইট ইজ অ্যান আর্থ্রোপড, উইচ
হ্যাঁ স্যার,
আমার মনে পড়েছিল কিন্তু স্যার আর্থ্রোপডসে মানে ওটা আমি কনফার্ম হতে পারলাম ইনসেক্টের মধ্যে তো পড়ে না
এক্স্যাক্টলি ইনসেক্টটা নয় ওটা ইয়া ইট ইজ আ ক্রাস্টেশিয়ান বাট উই কনজিউম দি
ক্রাস্টেশিয়ান
বাট উই কনজিউম দেম
ওকে
ওকে
থ্যাংক ইউ
টেকিং ক্রিকেটস এন্ড ওয়ান ভেরি ইম্পর্টেন্ট ইনসেক্টস হুইচ ইভেন ইন ইন্ডিয়া দে ইট দ্যাট ইজ টার্মাইট এগস দে টেক টার্মাইট
টার্মাইট ওকে স্যার
টার্মাইটস আর স্টিল কনজিউমড ইন
টার্মাইটস এগস
They are consumed.
For the tiger population,
yes,
tiger populations they consume termite.
Yes, yes sir. Thank sir, you, Priya. Sir, Africa side. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Priya. And now, Shomodi, welcome to the show. Thank you, Priya, very much.
Shomodi. Yes, sir.
Yeah, please.
Shunte
bachche. Perfect. Shuna jacche. Dekha jacche na. Shuna jacche. Okay, I think Shomodeep has lost his connection. Before he comes back, let's Sudipta start it. Oh, Shomodeep has come. Shomodeep, can you hear me? Shomodeep?
Yes, sir. Very good. I'm going
to ask you. Okay, okay. Come in.
Good afternoon, my respected teachers. Today I, Shomodeep Rai, student of BB College, PG Department, Zoology, discuss about my term paper, Biological Control of Pest. At first, we discuss what is pest. The term pest, derived from Latin word pestis, meaning plague or contagious disease. Pest is any organism which occurs in large numbers and conflict with man's welfare, convenience, and profit. Now let's define biological control. Biological control defined as the action of parasites, predators, and pathogens in maintaining another organism's density, for example, pest density at a lower average than would occur in their absence. Now let us discuss types of biological control of pest. There are three basic types of biological control of pests. One, importation, two, augmentation, and three, conservation. Importation or classical biological control involves the introduction of pest natural enemies to a new locale where they do not occur naturally. Control is greatest if the agent has temporal persistence so that it can maintain its population even in the absence of its target species. One of the earliest successes was in controlling Listeria purchasing in Australia using a predatory insect, Rhodolia cardinalis. Augmentation involves supplemental release of natural enemies that occur in a particular area, boosting the naturally occurring populations there. In inoculative release, small number of control agents are released at intervals to allow them to reproduce. In the hope of setting up longer term control, constituting prevention rather than cure. An example of inoculative release occurs in the horticultural production of several crops in greenhouses. Periodic releases of parasitoidal wasps, Encarsia formosa, are used to control greenhouse whitefly, while predatory mite, Phytocellulus parsimilis, is used to control of the two spotted spider mite. Now comes to conservation. The conservation of existing natural enemies in an environment is the third method of biological pest control. Cropping systems can be modified to favor natural enemies, a practice sometimes referred to as habitat manipulation. Providing a suitable habitat such as a shelter belt, hedgerow, or beetle bank, where beneficial insects such as parasitoidal wasps can live and reproduce. Now, let's come about biological control agents, predators. Predators are mainly free living species that directly consume large number of prey during their whole lifetime. Given that nearly many major crop pests are insects, many of the predators used in biological control are insectivorous species. For example, ladybird beetles, and in particular their larvae, devouring up to mainly feed upon voracious predators of aphids, and also consume mites and scale insects also. The spotted ladybird beetle, Colymomagina maculata, is also able to feed on eggs and larvae of Colorado potato beetle. The larvae of many hoverfly species principally feed upon aphids. Now let's come about parasitoids. Parasitoids lay their eggs on or in the body of insect host and ultimately kill the host. Most insect parasitoids are wasps or flies. Major groups are ichneumonid dwarfs, which mainly use caterpillars as host, braconid dwarfs, which attack caterpillars, as well as a wide range of other insects, including aphids. As for example, the parasitoid dwarfs, Aloides sp, parasitizing a gypsy moth caterpillar, a serious pest of forestry. Now let's come about role of pathogens in biological control. Bacteria. Bacteria used for biological control infect insects by their digestive tract. So they offer only limited options for controlling insects with piercing, sucking type of mouthparts such as aphid scale insects, etc. Bacillus thuringiensis, a soil-dwelling bacterium, is the widely applied species of bacteria used for biological control. Now let's come to fungi as biological control, biocontrol agent. Entomopathogenic fungi which cause diseases in insects include at least 14 species that attack aphids. Lecanicillium spp are deployed against whiteflies, thrips, and aphids. Bulbaria bassiana is mass produced and used to manage a wide variety of insect pests, including whiteflies, thrips, aphids, and weevils. The fungi cordyceps and metacordyceps are deployed against a wide spectrum of arthropods. Now come about viruses as biocontrol agent. Nucleopolyhedrosis virus infect and kill the beet armyworm insect, a serious pest of Beta vulgaris. Now let's talk about Oomycota as biocontrol agent. Lagenidium giganteum parasitizes the larval stage of mosquito, is a waterborne mold itself. Now let's talking about advantages and disadvantages of biological control. Advantages: it is highly specific to a particular pest. It can provide a long-term solution to a pest problem. There is no environmental contamination. And disadvantages: can sometimes fail in its specificity. It's a slow process, expensive at startup, doesn't completely destroy a pest. Now let's come about conclusion. There are huge number of losses of our grain and stored grain due to attack of pests every year worldwide as well as in India. And there is also some outbreak of diseases occurs by some pests. However, to minimize all these kind of losses, our scientists develop many chemical insecticides and pesticide sprays, etc. But due to inappropriate application of some chemical pesticides, some pests develop a resistance against such chemical pesticides. And moreover, successive use of chemical pesticides can be a cause of health hazards also. So to cope up with this problem, our scientists have developed biological control agents by introducing pest natural enemies, including pathogens, parasitoids, competitors, natural predators, etc., against pest species. After the introduction of biological control during last two decades, there is remarkable progress in various biopesticide strategies, including the development of transgenic.
Hello. Hello, Somodip. I think Somodip is on. We will have his discussion session later. Sudipta, please start your
respected our respected supervisor, Town Paper supervisor, Professor Dr. Sangeeta Lahiri ma'am, and Sri Raja Mukherjee sir, for their constant appreciating me in preparing my town paper. My reference is given below. Wikipedia, websites wikipedia.org, books, An Introduction to Biological Control by Robert Van Den Bosch, RFS Messenger, AP Gutierrez, and research paper given below. Thank you to all my respected teachers.
Somodip, thank you very much. Thank you, Somodip. And now the session is open for discussion.
Somodip.
Yes, sir.
In the conclusion, you said that genetically modified crop or transgenic crop can also be used as biological control agent to control pests. So, can you name any transgenic crop that is used for controlling pest infection?
Sir, BT cotton.
Okay. Yeah.
What is full?
Sir, what is sir?
BT.
What is the full form of BT?
Bacillus thuringiensis.
Okay. So, what it does?
Bacillus thuringiensis expressing genes are transferred to the crop so that they produce protein crystals which remains inactivated form.
What is the name of the protein? What is the name of the protein crystal produced by the BT?
Cry protein.
And how it causes the death of the insect?
When the insect ingests the leaves of BT crop, the alkaline pH of the insect's gut transforms BT crystals protein into its activated form, and it perforates the gut of insect and ultimately kills the insect.
Okay, thank you.
Very good, Somodip. Keep it up like this, always. And congratulations for qualifying NET also. I hope you will do very well in your life.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
And now, I would like to invite Sudipta. Sudipta,
yes.
Are you there? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Try to present. Somodip, presentation tech to Bangalore. Thik ache. Okay. Sudipta, the stage is yours.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir, shuru korbo?
Haan, shuru koro.
Acha. Good afternoon, respected teachers. Sir, I am Sudipta Kohler, student of Banwarilal Balotia College, Asansol, MSc 4th semester, PG Department of Zoology. Today I am here to deliver a PowerPoint presentation on the topic Integrated Pest Management and its Control on this auspicious occasion.
So, what is this new microphone?
What is pest? Pest is an organism which has characteristics that are regarded by human as injurious or unwanted. FAO, Food and Agricultural Organization, defined Integrated Pest Management as Integrated Pest Control, IPC, a system that in the context of associated environment and the population dynamics of pest species utilizes all the suitable techniques and methods in a compatible manner as possible and maintains the pest population at the levels below those causing economic injury. IPM can be defined as a scientific approach of a pest control which involves the various devices, principles, practices, in order to achieve more lasting and economical control of the pest and at the same time reduce the ecological disturbances. Now, the features of the integrated pest management. The IPM provides a systemic approach to a pest control. It begins with using best cultivation practices, following correct selection and culture of the plants, reduces potential for the pest and diseases. IPM is the selection and implementation of a pest control based on predicted economic, ecological and sociological consequences. In IPM, although different control measures are taken against the pest, but the important factor is the chemical factor should be done at the last stage of the practice. Thus, it declines the natural environment from the worst effect of chemical, which ultimately leads to biological magnification. The biological magnification is nothing but it's a phenomenon that eventually accumulates a non-biodegradable pesticides in an organism at a particular trophic level with a greater concentration than its preceding trophic level. That is called biological magnification. The IPM control methods includes cultural, physical, biological and chemical methods. Principal tactics and strategies of integrated pest management. A. It first identify the pest to be managed. Secondly, defining the management unit and agroecosystem. Thirdly, developing the pest management strategy. The fundamental strategy of the pest management is the coordinated use of a multiple tactics in a single integrated system. The goal is to keep the pest population and their damage to a tolerable level. It's a containment strategy, not an eradicated strategy. The fundamental tactics are applied which are economically and sociologically justified. So here, this is a diagram of a flow chart of IPM model of continual improvement. It includes the five steps. Step one, that is the knowledge and the key pest life cycle, natural enemies and growing area. Step two is the prevention, site selection, variety, time of the planting rotation, water and nutrition management, farm hygiene, pest host management. Step three is the observation, crop monitoring, pest prediction models, pheromone traps, yellow sticky traps. Step 4 is the intervention, mechanical controls, biological controls, chemical controls. And step 5 is the evaluation and planning, where we can review, monitor it, record it, and then adapt the views. Now, the aim of the strategy. A. It first reducing the level of a pest infection and then modifying the rate of the increase of the pest population. Reducing invade of the pest into that agroecosystem. It involves 8 stages. First is the prevention. Second is the monitoring and use of advice. Third is the decision, that is the threshold values. Fourth, preference of a non-chemical methods. Fifth, specific measures, least side effects. The necessary level, reduced dose. And 7, that is the avoid resistance of the pest. And 8 is the documentation assessment. Now, establishment of the economic threshold and injury level. Economic injury level is a critical factor, that is the EIL, that determine the damaging capacity of a pest, where EIL is equal to C divided by the VID, where C is the cost of the management per unit of production, V is the market value per unit of product, I is the crop injury per pest density, D is the damage per unit injury. Economic threshold level, it is nothing but it is a pest density at which the control should be started to prevent the reaching the economic injury level. So to calculate the economic threshold level, first we have to know the two things, how to identify the pest and then how to sample the crop environment. So this is a diagrammatic and graphical representation of the change in a pest population density over the time. Economic injury threshold and economic treatment threshold. Economic injury threshold, it is a level of a pest intensity that increasingly reduces the crop value, then the cost of the management. Economic treatment threshold, it is a level at which the action must be taken to prevent the economic damage, developing reliable monitoring and predictive techniques, evolving predictive models to overcome the socio-economic barriers to establish the integrated pest management. Now, this is a graph where the time is plotted in x-axis and number of pests is plotted in y-axis. So here we can see the curve, that is the solid line, the red one, that is the below EIL, that is economic injury level, the cost is greater than the benefit, where a control regulator is present. But when the pest population is without any control, that means the dotted line here, the above EIL, that is the above economic injury level, where benefit is greater than the cost. advantages and disadvantages of integrated pest management. Advantages: lower cost intervention, benefits to the environment, minimizes the residue hazards of pesticides, the pest control will not affect the crops. Disadvantages: like time and energy consuming, application of IPM takes time, more resources needed as substitution for pesticides. As IPM strategies differ from region to region, a separate plan is required for each region. Now, the control of the integrated pest management, cultural control. It involves a tilling, cultivation, crop rotation, control irrigation, use of trap crop, that is the cotton pests are trapped by ladyfinger, use of clean seed, clean cultivation and cultivation of resistance variety. Mechanical control, it involves the collection and killing of insects by working with hand, sometimes with aid of some simple equipment like bag, nets, traps and use of the hand picking, shaking, jerking, use of the light trap. Chemical control of the pest. Chemical controls like organophosphate, organochlorine, carbamates, pyrethroids, botanicals, all are used. Organophosphate. These compounds are generally polar and hydrophilic and are derivatives of mineral acid. That is dimecron, malathion, parathion are the examples. And organochlorine, these are chlorinated hydrocarbons, example like DDT, methoxy DDT. Carbamates, they are analog of carbamic acid, but their carbonyl hydrogen and amino hydrogen is replaced by the alkyl or aliphatic or aromatic groups. So pyrethroids, they are synthetical in origin, but analog to natural occurring botanical insecticides. Example like permethrin and deltamethrin. Botanicals, insecticides of plant origin, also known as botanilap. That is Azadirachta indica, that is the scientific name, the name insecticides. Biological control of the pest, predators. The searching behavior is important of predator-prey interaction in biological control. Adult predators may be monophagous, oligophagous and polyphagous. Predators use a visual and chemical clues to locate the plants with a prey and may also use a prey pheromones as clues. Bacillus thuringiensis is a gram-positive soil-dwelling bacterium commonly used as biological pesticides. Nematodes. Yes, sir.
Please conclude. Your 8 minutes is over. Okay. Please conclude. Go to the conclusion.
Aste aste share eta gutiya phalo. Haan, try to
correct. Acha, acha. Okay, 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 sir. Okay, sir. Fine, sir. Nematodes, parasites of insects are now available commercially for the agriculture application, general like the Stenonema and Heterorhabdides. So biological control like the PIP, that is plant incorporated protectants, and RNA interference pesticides. So hormonal control like ecdysone as insecticide, where the resorption of the old cuticle deposition, hardening and tanning of new cuticle can be used. And juvenile hormone can be also used as a hormonal control, that is the derivatives of this hormone can be also used as an analog. And mimics, that is called juvenoids, example like methoprene. And insect growth regulators, the commonly newer IGR example is the phenoxycarb. It can be of several types, juvenile hormones, chitin synthesis and triazine derivatives. That is shown in the figure, that is the Tribulium castaneum. It can show insecticidal effects, chitin content and cuticle formation. Now the genetic and biotechnological control of the pest. The genetic control, it involves sterility in the pest species by genetic manipulation. Biotechnological, here we can use a resistant plant, that is the recombinant DNA can be used to create a resistant variety, where the resistance is known and the most effective method has been inserting the gene sequences from other resistant organisms into a DNA of the target organism. Now, I want to conclude that integrated pest management will have an important role to play in use of biological, cultural, mechanical, chemical, genetical and biotechnological control can be an integral part of the integrated pest management. The modification of the pesticides use and will remain the most implemented form of biological control in agriculture IPM. So in the case study, the one new case study is the Simeri Durgapur develops a solar powered sprayers for a small marginal farmers. That is in the 6/9/2020. So they have developed a solar powered panels to control the environmental control and as well as to control the pest. And in addition, the most synthetic and natural pesticides are susceptible to the ineffectiveness due to the resistance buildup of the insects, and thus the only viable solution for the future is the integrated pest management. As a reference, I have taken help from these books, Entomology and the Pest Management, 6th edition, Larry Pedico and Marlene Rice, Current Concepts and Ecological Perspective, Dharambi Abrol, and a textbook of integrated pest management, G.S. Dhaliwal, and research papers like the Surendra K. Dara New Integrated Pest Management Paradigm for the Modern Age, and websites like https://www.ncipm.res.in. So lastly, I would like to express my special thanks of gratitude to our principal, sir, Dr. Omitabh Basu, sir, assistant professor, Dr. Arnab Ganguly, sir, head of the department, assistant professor, Dr. Shongita Lahiri, madam, Sri Raja Mukherjee, sir, guest lecturer, and as well as the Dr. Shuprabhat Mukherjee, sir, and all the assistant professors and teaching and non-teaching staffs of PG Department of Zoology who gave me this golden opportunity. Sir, madam, also helped me to complete this my term paper PowerPoint presentation on this integrated pest management and its control within this limited time frame. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It's open for discussion.
Thank you. Very nice presentation. Very informative presentation.
So, sir, ekta video chilo.
ওকে
শো ভিডিও দেখাতে হবে
আর দেখাতে হবে ছেড়ে দাও
আমি কয়েকটা কোশ্চেন করে নি খুব ভালো প্রেজেন্টেশন হয়েছে তো তুই আমাকে একটা ন্যাশনাল এজেন্সি আর একটা ইন্টারন্যাশনাল এজেন্সি নাম বল যারা পেস্ট কন্ট্রোল কে মনিটর করে
ন্যাশনাল এজেন্সি
ন্যাশনাল এন্ড ইন্টারন্যাশনাল এজেন্সি
এজেন্সি একটা করে নাম বল
বলো ঠান্ডা মাথায়
পারবি পারবি সহজ আচ্ছা ছেড়ে
দেবে হ্যাঁ গভর্নমেন্ট থেকে করে ন্যাশনাল গভর্নমেন্ট থেকে করে ওই হ্যাঁ নামটা তো উই ফার্মারের একটা
যেমন ধর পলিউশন কে কন্ট্রোল মনিটর করে পলিউশন কন্ট্রোল বোর্ড ঠিক আছে
হ্যাঁ 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 হ্যাঁ
কেও কন্ট্রোল করে আমাদের একটা বোর্ড আছে ঠিক আছে আচ্ছা শুন বল অর্গানোফসফেট মেকানিজম অফ অ্যাকশন কি হোয়াট ইজ দা মেকানিজম অফ অ্যাকশন অফ অর্গানোফসফেট ফসফেট ইনসেক্টিসাইডস ইনসেক্টিসাইডস বল যেগুলো আছে আমাদের
স্যার অর্গানোফসফেট
হ্যাঁ অর্গানোফসফেট
স্যার মেকানিজম অফ অ্যাকশনটা বলবো অর্গানোফসফেট কম্পাউন্ডস রিয়্যাক্ট করে ওই অ্যাক্টিভ সাইট অফ অ্যাসিটাইল কোলিনেস্ট্রেজ এনজাইম যেটা সেরিল হাইড্রক্সিল গ্রুপ আছে সেখানে সেখানে হ্যাঁ তো মানে এই মানে এই অর্গানোফসফেট কম্পাউন্ডস গুলো হচ্ছে মানে এগুলোকে বলে অ্যান্টি কোলিনেস্ট্রেজ এজেন্টস
ঠিক আছে
আর এটা ইনহিবিট করে নিউরোমাসকুলার জাংশন কে
ঠিক আছে তো তাহলে আমরা যদি কোনো পেস্ট ইন্টিগ্রেটেড পেস্ট ম্যানেজমেন্ট বলি তাহলে কি সাজেস্ট করবে হোয়াট উইল বি ইওর সাজেশন হোয়াট কাইন্ড অফ স্ট্র্যাটেজি যেটা ফার্মাটা ইউজ করবে ফর ইন্টারভেনশন অফ পেস্ট কি করবি বল
হ্যাঁ স্যার নতুন হ্যাঁ স্যার একটা তো স্যার যেমন সোলার পাওয়ার্ড যে স্প্রেয়ার্স গুলো বেরিয়েছে স্যার সেগুলো তো খুবই কাজ করবে মানে ওই কন্ট্রোল করতে পেস্ট কন্ট্রোল করতে
কিভাবে
মানে স্যার ওইটা এনভায়রনমেন্টাল যে পলিউশনটাকে ওটাকে রিডিউস করতে সাহায্য করবে
না কি করে করবে সোলার গুলো মেকানিজম ফাংশন কি ঠিক আছে সুদীপ্তা থ্যাংক ইউ
ওকে সো ইট ওয়াজ আ নাইস সেশন আই উড রিয়েলি লাইক টু thank all the students. Their presentations were very good. There are certain minor brushes which you people really need to improve. The first thing in a presentation is time. You have to maintain a time, the time given. The more you cross time, the more negative it becomes. It's not that you have to show everything, but what you show, it should be something which what people will absorb or grasp. This is one thing which you must always remember. The time is very important. You finish early, the more credit you will get. Of course, you don't finish in 1 minute. Just show something and go. But of course, when you show something, show as less as possible. There should be very less writing out fear and on a particular slide. And especially when we are talking through these conferencing softwares like Gmeet or Zoom or something, you should have very less things written directly. You can write them in a paper beside you and you can see that and then you can speak. That's fine. But what you show people will be as less as possible on the slide. Keep this in mind. And the second is, never speak about something which you don't know. Don't tell that thing at all. If you don't know about that thing, because it is written in a book, you don't have to show it. You can simply avoid it. 99.9% of the people will not even realize that you have not shown it. Okay, these are the two important things you remember. First is less writing, time during a conference or a presentation, and less, these are the things which you keep in mind. Thank you. So I would like to end today's session, and we will meet for the next session tomorrow at 11 o'clock. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.